بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن المبذرين كانوا إخوان الشياطين وكان الشيطان لربه كفورا Assalamu alaikum, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam. This week, from onward till the end of December, the shopping season starts here in America, and we have people going about and shopping and buying, as they say, shop till you drop. What is this consumerism where we buy and buy and buy? It's a very different type of society that started after the Industrial Revolution. And it's not only in the West, in America or Europe, but across the world we see people are obsessed with the acquisition, with acquiring goods. Before, there was a materialistic society which was different, which was more money. And the point of that was that you would have money, you could probably build yourself a bigger palace. This is like 1,000 years ago, but there was nothing much else you could do if you had more money. But now people have ways of spending that money, whether it's an exotic vacation or the latest gadgets, but they want to buy and buy. And we buy so many things that we don't have enough room in our homes. We put it in the basement or in the garage, and then we store this stuff. If we don't have enough space in the garage, in the storage unit, we'll pay a monthly $80 a month to store all this stuff in our that we have bought over the years. How much of a society, consumeristic society, have we become where we want to buy and buy and buy this and buy that? I want this, I need this, that. If someone was to write a history book 100 years from now, this would be a textbook example. Not too far from here, a couple miles from here in Taylorsville, right here in Utah, a few years back on Black Friday, where there were hundreds, maybe thousands of people waiting at the door. As soon as Walmart opened their door, there was a huge crowd stampede, rush of people came in just to get their hands on the latest deal, what, 50% savings, 25% savings, and buy it and run to the cashier. In that stampede, a woman was crushed, trampled to death. Yes, this is the state of our consumerism. Okay, now we have to think that we as Muslims, does Quran and Sunnah, Hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, have any guidance for us? In the Hadith, we find the Hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam that لا تزال قدم عبد, a person's feet on the Day of Judgment will not move from its place till he answers hatta yus'al an arba, till he is asked about four questions. And one of those four questions that will be asked of him on the Day of Judgment is min ayna iktasabta, where did you earn this money and where did you spend it? In other words, just having a halal livelihood, halal income, is not sufficient. If it's haram, may Allah protect us, haram income will bring the azab, the punishment of Allah. But on halal income, halal earnings, there is accountability, hisab. Where did we spend it? Quran, when we look, open the Quran, there are two ayats that pop up regarding our spending. One is in Surah A'raf, that where Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا, eat and drink, وَلَا تُسْرِفُوا, and do not waste. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْرِفِينَ, Allah does not love those who waste. If we buy a 5-bedroom house when a 3-bedroom house is enough for us, this purchase of a 5-bedroom house would be considered israf, because those 2 bedrooms are extra and beyond our need. There's another ayah in the Quran in Surah Bani Israel, innal mubadhirin, those who are extravagant in their spending, kanu ikhwana shayateen, they are the brothers of shaitan. Now, Quran, Allah Azza wa Jal is comparing the spendthrift, those who are extravagant, to the brothers of shaitan. What is the comparison, the similarity between shaitan and those who are extravagant, who show off? who flaunt their money. That is the meaning of tabdhir, as compared to israf, which is mentioned in Surah A'raf. Israf is to spend beyond our needs, and tabdhir, being compared to shaitan, the brothers of shaitan, is to show off our money, to flaunt it. What is the comparison between shaitan and those who flaunt their money? Well, in Surah Baqarah, Allah Azza wa Jal describes the works of shaitan. Inna shaitan yuridu an yuqiya baynakum al-adawa. Shaitan, he intends to create animosity and hatred amongst people. Put hatred in the hearts of individuals for each other, and also between different groups, different stratas in society. So one group, for example, based on color, one group has a darker skin color, one group has a lighter skin color, and shaitan wants to create animosity and hatred between them. Innama yuridu shaitan an yuqiya baynakum al-adawata wal-baghda. Now, in society, from the time of Adam alayhi salam, there has always been rich and poor, haves and have-nots. What happens is that if the rich flaunt their money, show off their money, display their wealth, their extravagant lifestyle, what happens to the heart of this poor person who does not have enough money to put food on the table for his family, who cannot buy medicine for his children who are sick? His feelings are indescribable, are unimaginable. That rich person who is flaunting his wealth, he in fact is driving a dagger, an emotional dagger, through the heart of this poor person. When the time comes, when the time is ripe and right, this poor person in society, the poor, they will rise up against the rich, as they have done in the French Revolution and in the Communist Revolution, and they will put an actual dagger through the heart of this rich person. So basically, the one who flaunts his wealth, he is creating hate in the heart of this poor person, just as shaitan creates hate and animosity between people. In this regard, they are the brothers of shaitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. If we look at the lifestyle of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the believers in Medina Munawwara during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and afterwards, if an outsider was to come inside Medina, what would he notice? What would stand out? I'm not speaking of Masjid al-Nabawi, their prayers inside the masjid. I'm talking about their markets, their interaction, the way they behaved and lived. What would stand out? Two things would stand out. Number one, haya, modesty. Each and every single individual, male and female, when they interacted with each other, and yes, the male and female, they interacted with each other, but their interaction was filled with haya from head to toe. Young and old, male and female, there was haya and modesty. And the second thing that would stand out is their lifestyle was simple. They had a simple lifestyle. They did not have a lavish lifestyle. They spent on their needs, and whatever was extra, they would spend on those who were more deserving, who were less fortunate than them. Now you might think, well, they didn't have money to spend. Well, they did towards the latter years of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's worldly life, towards the last 1 or 2 years. And then after Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world, money started pouring in, wealth started coming in from all over Arabia and the world, but their lifestyle did not change. Just simply because they had an increase in income, increase in revenue, did not necessarily mean that they had a different lifestyle. No, their lifestyle was simple. أَقَلُّهُمْ تَقَلُّفًا. And we compare that to our lifestyle. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. What is our lifestyle? The woman of our house, whether it be our mother, our sister, our daughter, our wife, has dozens and dozens of pairs of shoes. Is there really a need? Is this not israf? And the clothes, our wife or our daughter, she will not wear a dress to a certain party, and you ask her, why aren't you wearing this dress tonight to this party? She will say, I wore this same dress a year ago, and there was a certain lady who has seen me in this dress a year ago, and that certain lady is coming to this party tonight. I do not want to be seen by that lady wearing the same dress, or else she will think I don't have any other clothes. Huh? This is the state of our affairs, so artificial, so shallow. Huh? Look at our weddings. One thing that has happened with COVID is the weddings have become a lot more simple. I have officiated weddings, nikah, few families, 3 or 4 families, and the nikah is done between the husband, the boy and the girl, and they're happily married. Khalas, they go home. Purpose, mission accomplished. We don't need those extravagant weddings. This proves, COVID proves, that we do not need those laughable. They are laughable, the amount of money that we spend. How much money does this Muslim Ummah have? It comes out at our weddings. And we have the audacity to complain about a Saudi prince who spent $10 million on a wedding. We are doing the exact same thing. We have $100,000, so we spend $100,000. He had $10 million, so he spent $10 million. If we had $10 million, then we would have spent $10 million. There is no difference whatsoever between that extravagant wedding on which $10 million was spent and between this wedding on which $100,000 were spent. Both are devoid of simplicity. Both are void of simplicity. And the car, sometimes people drive a car. The dumbest decision that a person can make, financial decision that an individual can make, is to buy a car to impress other people, to buy an expensive car so he can impress other people. Today we buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't like. What is the purpose of this car? If a car is reliable, that's all we need, a reliable car that takes us from point A to point B. That is purpose accomplished. We don't need an expensive car. And many times, the majority of the people who buy expensive cars, it's to impress other people. There is a real issue here, low self-esteem. In other words, they are seeking validation from other people by showing off their car. That is what it boils down to. Otherwise, why would a person spend $30,000, $40,000 on a car that he doesn't need? An extra pricey, expensive car. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And then on top of that, we take a loan because to support this lavish lifestyle, our income is not sufficient. And that itself is proof that this is israf. Because if we are living beyond our means and borrowing money to support this lavish lifestyle, this itself is the definition of israf. Yes. Now, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a loan. Yes. The Sahaba took a loan. Yes. Our pious predecessors took a loan. Yes. But their loan was for a different purpose. The longest ayah in the Quran is in Surah Baqarah, Ayatul Dain, is called the ayah regarding loan. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu idha tadayantum bidaynin ila ajalin. Why? Allah explains the etiquettes and guidelines, the do's and don'ts of borrowing money for the lender and for the borrower. But our loan is very different than the loan that we find that was common amongst the Sahaba. They took a loan, or Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam took a loan. It's hard to even fathom and wrap our heads around it. They took a loan to actually help someone else. They took on and incurred a personal debt so they could help someone else. Someone else's need to be fulfilled. Or they were starving and they needed to put food on the table, so they borrowed money for their personal need, not for consumption, not for their desires and wants. Yes, and that is the difference. Today, the average American, he has a debt of $90,000, $96,000. $460. Imagine, that is the average debt. And $16,061 is the average credit card debt in America. That means the clothes that we buy, the shirt that I have bought with my credit card, if I have bought it with my credit card, I don't even own the shirt on my back. And then the total debt, 87% of Americans are in debt. 47% of Americans have a credit card debt. And we as a Muslim community, Ummah in America, are not too far behind. We are walking that same path, and that is going to lead to that same destination, which is being overwhelmed by debt. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has sought protection. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min ghalabati ad-dayn. Oh Allah, I seek protection in being overwhelmed by debt. Imagine you wake up in the morning and you are debt free. You don't owe a single penny to any credit card company, bank, or credit union. You are debt-free. Everything you make, 100% is yours. That is a feeling that you would like to have. How do we get there? Number one is that if we have bought a house on mortgage, we need to pay that house off ASAP, as soon as possible. Put every single penny and dime that we make towards that house. We have no business going on a vacation or eating out at a restaurant. We have no business being inside a restaurant unless we work there. If we need to pay off, if we have a house that we need to pay off, every single penny and dime should be used to pay off that house. And number two, we live a simple lifestyle. If a person lives a simple lifestyle, he is the king in America. We need to differentiate. Let me put it this way. We need to differentiate between need and desire. Allah is Razzaq. Inna Allaha huwa Razzaq. He has promised to take care of our needs, not our wants and desires and wishes and wish lists. Our desires are never ending. That is why a human desire cannot be fulfilled in this world. And that is why Allah has created Jannah. Only Jannah can fulfill and satisfy a person's desire. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, if a person has one valley of gold, he will wish for two valleys of gold, and nothing will fill his desire, his stomach, except for the dirt of the dust of the grave. Our desires are never ending. So before we make a purchase, we think, do I need this or do I want it? There's a difference. هذه ضرورة. Is this a need? Is this a need? Do I really need this or do I want this? And if we really want it, then we need to save up for it. Yes, we are used to this instant gratification. I want it now. Instant gratification. No, save up for it. The pleasure that you will derive from saving up for a high-priced item and then paying for it cash, that is indescribable. Imagine a person walks into a car. He can into a car dealership, and he can barely afford a bicycle. He has $200. He makes a $200 down payment and drives off the dealership with a brand new, shiny, zero mileage car. And then he will boast that I bought this car, pardon me, with the $200 that you have paid as down payment. The most you have bought, the most that could be said is that you have bought the headlight or one or two tires of this car. When have you bought this car? You will have bought this car after 60 months, after 5 years of making payments. Then when this car is only worth in the market $1,000 or $1,200, then you can boast and say, I bought this car. With the exception of a house and a student loan. These are the two exceptions. With the exception of a house and a student loan, if you cannot buy cash, if you cannot pay cash for it, then you cannot afford it. Yes, you cannot afford it. Simple as that. And imagine if we live this simple lifestyle. Imagine being debt free and not owing a single penny, and everything you make is yours to keep at the end of the month. And we could help, if we have that disposable income, we can invest, yes, for our own future. We can invest for our children's future. Who knows what the financial situation in this country is going to be 10 years from now. We can give them a push. We can give them a head start in life. Pay off their student loan. Buy them a house. We can do so much for them. And we can help our extended family. We can help people who are in need. Sometimes we want to donate. We want to help. We want to help the widows and the orphans, but we don't have any money to give. Why? Because we are living such a lavish lifestyle. We don't have anything left at the end of the month. So even if we want to, we cannot. Imagine how we can help people and feel good about it. And it could become a dhakhira, a treasure for us in the hereafter. And most of all, do we want to be a community, a Muslim ummah in America that runs after toys? These are literally called toys. Do we want to run after these toys? Or do we want to be a community that is anchored in financial stability, that has a moral compass, that points us in the right direction, that does not spend lavishly on our desires? As a matter of fact, that puts emphasis on a person's character, not the color of his credit card, not the color of his skin, obviously, and not the color of his credit card either, but on his character. How much integrity does he have? Not the type of car he drives, but how much honesty. Is he an honest person or not? Is he a loyal friend or not? Is he kind and compassionate or not? Does he come to his neighbor's aid and help and rescue when his neighbor needs him? Ask your parents, ask your grandparents. There was a time not too long ago where in society the emphasis was on these traits, and a person's value in the community was based on these character traits, not on something superficial or artificial as his possessions or what, how, or where he lives, or how big his house is, or what type of car he drives. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us a debt-free life. And may Allah azza wa jal enable all of us to live a simple life. Wa ma alayna illa al-balagh. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
يا من أجبت دعاء نوح فانتصر وحملته في فلكك المشحون يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا بقولك كوني يا من أجبت دعاء نوح فانتصر